Hi everyone, and thank you for joining us. Today's presentation will deal about reactive leachables and will be given by myself, Anke Reumer, and my colleague Koen Nuitz. We are both study directors at Nelson Labs Europe. As an introduction, I would like to revisit the APREX case. As you will see, it's very relevant to the work that we will present here. Most of the people who have been working in extractables and leachables for a longer time, and then especially from a pharma perspective, will be more or less familiar with this APREX case. Now, APREX is the commercial product name for EPO, a human recombinant EPO. And it's injected subcutaneously in people, for example, who are suffering from chronic kidney disease, to increase their hematocrit values, to increase their red blood cell count. Now, this APREX was introduced onto the market in the early 90s without major side effects. So that's what you're actually looking at here in this figure. So from early 90s, still 98, no major side effects. But from 98 onwards, there was an increase in the incidence of a form of anemia, which was called pure red blood cell aplasia. And this caused a serious adverse event in patients who were already weakened because of their disease. Now, of course, this case was heavily investigated. And what did they find out? They found out that there was a change in the formulation. So prior to 98, a formulation using serum albumin as protein stabilizer was used, but after 98 this was changed to the use of polysorbate 80 as protein stabilizer because of the risk of mad cow disease linked with the use of albumin. Now, something very important I have to tell you here is that this formulation was contained in the same container closure system, in the same pre-filled syringe. So the materials which were in contact with this formulation were exactly the same using both these formulations. Now, as the previous figure already told us, of which we could deduce from this previous figure, is that this container closure system was compatible with the use of this serum albumin. But this formulation with polysorbate 80, the new formulation, there the container closure system was found to be incompatible. A different leachable pattern was observed in this drug product containing the polysorbate 80, and the leachables were found to be related to the rubber plunger present in this prefilled syringe. Now, what can we learn already from the APREX case at this moment? Leachables are formulation dependent. Now, for the people who are less familiar with the concept of leachables, here a very simplistic example of the concept of leachables. So leachables are compounds that are actually present in the packaging. So here we are looking at a glass vial, and this glass vial can be closed with a rubber stopper. Leachables are then compounds that are present in this rubber stopper and that can migrate over time into the drug formulation. So now here's a small animation. So really compounds that leach over time, migrate over time from your packaging into your drug formulation. This leaching process is, as we learned from the APREX case, formulation dependent, but also a time dependent process. Okay, back to the APREX case. So what did we learn? The container closure system was compatible with the old formulation with the human serum albumin, but was found to be incompatible when they changed the formulation to the use of polysorbate 80. And this incompatibility was linked to the different leachable pattern that was observed. And once this was recognized or detected, the pharma company changed their plunger component to a coated version, as you can see here. And this then clearly resulted in a drop of this incident of antibody-mediated pure red cell aplasia. So these levels went back to normal. So this occurrence of this PRCA came with a change in formulation and disappeared then with a change in the components. So clearly it had to do with the interaction of the materials with the drug product, and for that it was meant to be to one or more of these detected vegetables. So now we are looking here at a list of leachables that was reported to be present in the IPREX formulation with a new formulation containing the polysorbate 80. Now, most of these leachables are linked to the vulcanizer that was used to cross-link the polymer in this rubber stopper. And in a traditional assessment, you look at these compounds to the structure, chemical structure, and you will look into the toxicological data that is available for these compounds or for related structures. And you typically evaluate acute systemic toxicity, irritation, sensitization, mutagenicity, carcinogenicity, and reprotox. But a question: who could have predicted an antibody-mediated immune response based upon this leachable profile? So the point I want to make is that although the IPREX case is often used to emphasize the importance of a good and thorough leachable assessment, in doing so, no one could actually have been able to predict or avoid this effect, this antibody-mediated immune response. Now, in those early days, the hypothesis about the mode of action of these different leachables in this new IPREX formulation was that they caused an adjuvant-like property. So they boosted the immune response, and this resulted then in the production of anti-drug antibodies. Now, these anti-drug antibodies were then able to not only attack the EPO that was administered through the injection of the IPREX, but was also able to attack the endogenous EPO, so the EPO that is produced by the human body itself. And this then resulted in a substantial decrease of red blood cells. So it is actually the opposite of the intended effect, an increase of red blood cells. Now, this was a hypothesis, and they tried to verify this hypothesis in animal models. So they administered these leachables to animals, but there no anti-drug antibodies were observed. So they could not claim that this hypothesis was actually the mode of action. Then in 2014, FDA publishes something new, a new line of thinking. Leachables can also be reactive, and they can form covalent bonds with biologics. And these reaction products can then lead to immune responses. Now, this thinking is not only published in the FDA guidance, actually PQRI has also very similar wordings, and this reference of this PDA journal, my colleague Kuhn will come back to that later in the presentation. Now, what does this FDA guidance tell us? So, in the frame of this presentation, we will only focus on the container closure considerations. So, it tells us that materials which are leached from the container closure system, that they can be a source of compounds, of materials that can enhance immunogenicity, and this then by either chemically modifying a protein or a peptide therapeutic, or the first hypothesis of the IPREX case, that they can have a direct immune adjuvant activity effect. And this FDA guidance actually also contains a reference to the IPREX case. Luckily for us, this FDA guidance also contains some recommendations on what should we do to assess this immunogenicity risk. So we have to do extractables testing, leachables testing, because this will give us information to assess the attributes of the container closure system, of our packaging system that could interact with or could degrade the therapeutic protein. This information will also help us to assess the effect of these leachables or the container closure system on the quality of our product. So we also have to do product quality testing. And this whole set of information will then help us to do a proper risk evaluation about the compatibility of our container closure system and our drug product formulation. Now, then, an important question. Very nice wording here, but how should we do this? Of course, the first thing we have to do is extractables testing. So in extractables testing, we are going to look only at the packaging material. We're going to look only at the container closure system. So for example, I've depicted here a glass file, and this glass file can be closed with a rubber stopper there on top. Or you can also assess the components of a pre-filled syringe that will come into contact with the drug product. And then you're going to apply some harsh conditions on these materials because you want to extract as much of the compounds that are present in there and you want to identify them. This then results in sometimes a long list of extractable compounds that are present in your packaging and that you were able to extract from them. Now, based on this list, you can do your initial toxicological evaluation. And for this, of course, as you know, ethylco tools are available. This list will also help you to design a proper leachable study. But then a very important question for you, Koen. These reactive leachables, is there maybe a way we can predict in silico whether they are actually able to react with the protein?
Well, the good news there is that, yes, we can predict this. For this, we will go back again to the FDA guidance because it is here to guide us all. Now, there's two very basic assumptions that we have used and that comes from the FDA guidance itself. And the first one here would be that we look at chemical modification of the protein drug itself. Now, for the chemical modification, we assume that this means covalent bonding itself, which is also specified later on in the PQRI text and also in the paper related to it. We look at covalent bonding and not at non-covalent bonding, because a non-covalent bonding itself is short-lived in nature and it's also reversible. So if you compare this to the covalent bonding itself, the non-covalent ones are actually very low in impact on the protein drug. And this brings us to the second assumption. We look at protein drugs and we do not look at small molecule APIs. Now we look at the protein drugs because a protein drug is by definition a very large compound itself. Is very complex in structure and also has an abundance of binding sites on their surface. Now, this might seem like a bad thing, but this actually has a very clear advantage. A protein itself is built up out of amino acids, and the amino acids itself, which can react with a leachable compound, are nucleophilic in nature. This means that they will react in a certain way with a leachable compound itself. Now, which amino acids are we talking about? We are talking about cysteine, we are talking about lysine, histidines, everything that has a nucleophilic way of reacting with another compound itself. So the leachable compound itself that we will be looking at will be an electrophile. Now, this is very good for us. It makes also the prediction of reactivity much, much easier. Now, how do we start with the entire prediction itself? Now, we will look at our leachable compounds, which have been identified during the extractable study itself. So we actually know which compounds we are looking at. So we have a chemical structure of it. So first of all, what we will do is we look at which parts of the compound itself can react. Now, these are the functional groups itself. Now, a functional group will have a certain way of reacting itself. And we have simplified the way that it can react by considering the protein as a nucleophile itself. So which means we will have a certain set of reaction mechanisms in which the leachable compound can react. We will come back to later on this one when we do the further explanation. Now, we have the way that it, how it can react, but there is also still the way, well, not certain, not the way, but the, if it can react itself. And this is the most important thing with the in silico prediction itself. Can the leachable actually react with the protein drug? And for this, we use the OCD QSAR toolbox, which is QSAR software commissioned by the OECD itself. Now, this piece of software is very good at grouping compounds in certain categories. So it can really identify the functional groups, it can identify reaction mechanisms, and also, and this is the best part of it all, it can also identify the reactivity profile of the compound itself. Now, this is for theory. Now, how would this actually look like? If we look at three example leachable compounds, the C13 rubber oligomer, an acrylic acid, and a palmitic acid. These are three leachables that we see in a wide variety of studies. So first of all, what we would do is we look at the functional groups. If you look at the C13 rubber oligomer, we see an alkene and a bromide on the alpha position. So this is an allyl bromide. For the acrylic acid, we've seen again an alkene and a carboxylic acid. So this would be an alpha-beta unsaturated carboxylic acid. And then we see palmitic acid, which is a carboxylic acid. So this is for the functional groups. Now, secondly, what we do is we look at the reaction mechanisms in which it can react with a protein drug. These are further explained into this paper published in the PDA journal. And this would be the five following reaction mechanisms itself. So we would have a nucleophilic substitution reaction and an aromatic nucleophilic substitution reaction. We also have a Michael addition, a shift-based reaction, and an acylation itself. Now, if you apply this again to the three leachable compounds itself, then we see that the rubber oligomer can undergo a nucleophilic substitution reaction with a protein. The acrylic acid will undergo a Michael addition, whereas the palmitic acid itself does not react at all with a protein. So this is purely a theoretical approach itself from functional group up until reaction mechanism. Now, what we can also do is predict in the end the reactivity. And the reactivity is based on three empirical models. So this is based on real life data that is available, and a model has then been made out of it. In the OCD QSAR toolbox, there are three different models available to us. One is based on the reaction of glutathione. So glutathione is used as a substitute for a protein. So we can consider this as a generic protein, which then reacts with different compounds itself. The output is a qualitative, will be qualitative, because it is most of all convenient if you would consider this with the other three models itself. So the output for the glutathione model would be going from extremely reactive to suspect reactivity. We have a second model, which is based on a short peptide, which has a lysine amino acid present as a reactive amino acid. Again, here we have three subdivisions instead of five subdivisions, going from reactive up until unreactive. Then we have the third model, which is basically the same as the lysine model, but instead of a lysine as a reactive amino acid, we have cysteine as a reactive amino acid. So again, also here, the output goes from reactive up until unreactive. Now, to simplify all of this, we have grouped the three different reactivity profilers into the Nelson react itself. So it would be easier to identify them to being highly reactive, moderately reactive, or low reactivity. Also, they are divided, as you can see here in the table itself. Now, again, the example of our three example leachable compounds. First of all, we have the C13 rubber oligomer. Only the glutathione model gives the results being extremely reactive. Since we are always very conservative in what we will evaluate, we will just consider the C13 rubber oligomer as being highly reactive also with the Nelson react itself. If we look at acrylic acid, we see that the glutathione model in this case does not yield any results. However, the lysine model and the cysteine model give a gray zone and an unreactive result. This we will combine. Again, we are being conservative and we will call this reactivity moderate. Then, if we look at the palmitic acid itself, which we already saw didn't have any reaction mechanism available, the glutathione itself does not give any result, and the lysine and the cysteine models both give it as an unreactive compound. For the Nelson react, we will consider this to be low reactivity. Why do we keep this at low reactivity? Certain compounds, even though that they would have a reaction mechanism, would be considered unreactive in the glutathione, lysine, or cysteine model itself. However, since it does have a reaction mechanism or might have a reaction mechanism, we will consider them to be low reactive anyway. Again, we are conservative in our assessments of these things. Now, we have not looked only at these three compounds. We have screened an entire list. We have actually screened our entire database on reactivity, which is possible and which can occur with a protein drug itself. So this would mean we have a list of over 3,500 compounds that have been screened and that are completely assessed and can be evaluated later on itself. Now again, this is an in silico model. And what we would like to do is also, of course, see if this in silico model can be verified with a real example. And luckily, we were able to do this, and this will be done by Anke.
So indeed, Koen, we did some wet lab experiments. And for these wet lab experiments, we selected insulin as a model protein. And also, we selected some leachables, and we looked at potential reaction products that we could find. So, as leachables, we looked again at the Ornelson React database, and we selected there six leachables that we frequently observe in leachable studies and that are predicted to be low reactive. We also selected six leachables that are predicted to be highly reactive. And of course, the question is, did they react, yes or no? So we bought insulin glargine reference standard, because from this insulin, we know the structure, we know the chemical formula, and we also know the molar mass, which is very important for the experiments we did. Then we prepared a highly concentrated stock solution of those 12 selected leachables in a very volatile solvent. We then spiked a very small amount of this highly concentrated stock solution of leachables to lyophilized insulin and let the solvent evaporate as quickly as possible. We then incubated this insulin with spiked leachables for 4 days at 40 degrees and subsequently prepared it for instrument analysis. And we used a Q-Exactive Orbitrap for our instrument analysis. And these are actually the results, of course, of the results of our wet lab experiment. So on top, you see a very nice peak, a very nice mountain, and this corresponds to insulin glargine. The mass spectrum we obtained for this peak is depicted in the below picture now. And for people who are not familiar with mass spectrometry, here actually the numbers and also the isotopic pattern, the pattern you're looking here, counts. Now, from these numbers, we were able to deduce the molecular mass, which was 6063. Actually, we are looking here at a nice mass spectrum of insulin glargine. So this mass spectrum we used as a reference mass spectrum in our wet lab experiments. Now, looking back at the top figure there with those peaks, the second figure there is actually the insulin glargines to which we spiked those leachables. So this gives a pretty different pattern. Now, if we take the mass spectrum of one of those peaks, for example, we get the mass spectrum that is now depicted below. Again, from these numbers here, we were able to deduce the molecular mass, and now it's 6,242. Now, we have a mass difference here of 178. Now, from this mass, we can also deduce the molecular formula, and this mass corresponds to C13H22. This actually tells us that we are looking here at a reaction product covalent bonding between a C13 rubber oligomer and insulin. Now, we did the same approach for the other leachables. And here again, some results. So on top, you see the mass spectrum that corresponds to the reaction product between chloroacetophenone and insulin. Then in the second line, you see the reaction products between diterbutyl benzoquinone and also isofrone diisocyanate. And then the below picture represents the reaction products between insulin and oxaspiro and epoxystearic acid. So the conclusion of our wet lab experiments, or the results of our wet lab experiments, looking at the leachables that were predicted to be low reactive. Now, there are 5 out of 6 of those leachables. We did not find or did not detect a reaction product between these leachables and insulin, except for the oxaspiro there. Oxaspiro, if you look at the chemical structure of oxaspiro, it actually has a functional group to which we can relate a reaction mechanism. It can react through Michael addition with a protein. So actually, we were not surprised that we saw a reaction product between this oxaspiro compound and insulin. Then the experiments for those reachables that were predicted to be highly reactive. Here, for five leachables, we were able to find a reaction product between the leachable and insulin, except for the deoctyl disulfide. Now, again, deoctyl disulfide is a compound that preferentially reacts with cysteines. And knowing our insulin or insulin glargine model, this does not contain free cysteine. So again, we were not surprised that we did not find a reaction product between this compound and insulin. So Koen, what do you think about these results? I think they are pretty in line with our expectations.
And they actually are completely in line, well, more or less in line with our expectations. Honestly, this also gave us quite a warm, fuzzy feeling because the theory has been confirmed by the experiment itself. Now, there still remains one important question, which is when would you actually use the reactivity of extractables and leachable compounds in our entire study setup? Now, again, an ENL study itself begins always with an extractable study in which we are looking for potential leachable compounds. We perform an initial risk assessment to see which compounds would be of interest to follow up during the leachable study itself, of which the results will be used for submission with the regulatory authorities itself. Now, right now, what the risk assessment consists of is a prediction of toxicity itself. This is done completely within the industry itself. And this is also what we offer with our fast initial toxicological screening, so our FIT screening. This actually considers the interaction of the leachable compound itself with the patient. So this really is a direct risk. This is our mutagenicity risk. This is our carcinogenicity risk, the reproductivity risk. So really toxicity itself. With this, in this way, we are able to select which compounds would be of concern during the leachable study itself. And if then they show up in the leachable itself, we can, or not show up preferably, we can actually completely support our material choice. Because in the end, what we want to do with a leachable study, with an ENL study, is that we support the choice that we have made for the materials that have been used in our packaging material itself. So this really goes for direct risks and toxicity risk itself. Now, what we are now able also to do is actually look at reactivity of the compounds. So in the first way, this would mean that we are able to assess the direct risk of a leachable compound towards the protein drug. So this would be a concern for the efficiency of the protein drug itself, of the stability of the protein drug itself. So we are able to supply you with compounds which can be followed up during the stability studies, which are also mandatory to be performed. Secondly, what we are able to do right now is look at the indirect risk that a leachable compound can pose towards the patient. So this is not direct toxicity, but this is really the immunogenic risk that a compound poses to the patient. Again, both these results, so the stability risk and also the immunogenic risk, makes you able to properly support the choices that you have made for your material used in the primary packaging. So thank you for your attention. Below there are the email addresses of Ank and me, of course also of our scientific director. And if you would have any more questions, we are always available